Sabermetrics Network. Today we'll be discussing how to use field goal percentage in basketball analysis. If you forget everything you know about field goal percentage, it seems like it should be the most discussed stat, ranking players by batting average rather than by hits when you're comparing scores. In a simplified world, that's what's best for the team, making shots without missing shots. But as everyone who follows basketball knows, if you rank any league by field goal percentage, you don't end up with a list of the most effective scorers. So why is this okay? What's going on with the best players that keeps them from having better field goal percentages? Making shots and not missing shots are two of the most important things a player can do on the floor. In order to use that information to understand someone's ability as a scorer, though, we have to keep a close eye on two other factors. The first is that some are shooting more three-pointers than others. And the way to think about this is there's something people always forget when discussing field goal percentage. They'll take someone like Dwight Howard or Reggie Johnson and say, well, of course he has a high field goal percentage. All he does is dunk and hit layups, which is true. But that doesn't make it less effective. If I shoot 45% on mid-range jumpers, it doesn't matter that those are harder to make than the 60% of dunks that Reggie Johnson's making, because their value to the team is exactly the same. You still get 2 points for making it and none for missing. This fallacy was developed because of the highest field goal percentages belong, nearly without exception, to big men. And it's a strange position to take that guards are all worse in a category called shooting percentage when most of them can, you know, actually shoot better than the big men. When you take into account three-pointers, though, it makes more sense. There's a common statistic that you'll find on Basketball Reference, on KenPom, other places too, called effective field goal percentage. And it combines twos and threes better. By giving you credit for an extra half-made field goal on every three-pointer made, just like you're credited with 50% more points on a three-pointer made. So effective field goal percentage leaders are more evenly distributed among the positions. But the leaders in effective field goal percentage will still usually be role player big men and spot-up three-point shooting artists. And that's true because top players are responsible for a larger chunk of the offense than role players are. They take more shots. So think about it like this. Let's say I get 10 opportunities to shoot during the game, and I choose to take 5 of the shots. Now, in all likelihood, those are the 5 easiest shots of the 10, so let's say I make 4. So my game shooting percentage is 80%, whereas maybe if I had taken those 5 harder shots, I would have only made 2, so my 10-shot shooting percentage would have just been 60%. The last piece of the puzzle is that by shooting more, I'm actually improving the shooting percentages of my teammates. If I'm the one taking the tough shots at the end of the shot clock, that means that my teammates aren't, so their shooting percentages will look better on fewer shots. That's all for today. I hope you have a better understanding of how to analyze shooting percentages. John Templon will be back with more for Basketball Prospectus next Tuesday on the Sabermetrics Network.